From the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Some Sadducees, those who deny that there is a resurrection, came forward and put this question to Jesus, saying, "Teacher, Moses wrote for us, if someone's brother dies, leaving a wife but no child, his brother must take the wife and raise up descendants for his brother. Now there were seven brothers. The first married a woman but died childless. Then the second and the third married her, and likewise all seven died childless. Finally, the woman also died. Now at the resurrection, whose wife will that woman be? For all seven had married her." Jesus said to them, "The children of this age marry and remarry, but those who are deemed worthy to attain the coming age and to the resurrection of the dead neither marry nor are given in marriage. They can no longer die, for they are like angels, and they are the children of God, because they are the ones who will rise. That the dead will rise, even Moses made known in the passage about the bush, when he called out, 'Lord, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob.' And he is God not of the dead, but of the living, for to him all are alive." The Gospel of the Lord. All right. So, as I begin my homily today, I want to do a very quick parish survey here, okay? How many of you ladies here can say that they completely understand men? Put your hands up, okay? Let's see some hands flying up there. I see not a single one. Okay, very honest group. Very good, okay. Now, how many of you men here today don't understand women at all? Put your hands up there. Okay, you see lots of hands going up there, pretty much what I thought. Just about everybody, and those of you men that didn't put up your hands are too afraid to put up your hands, right? Your wives are saying, "Yeah, you better be afraid." We can't figure them out. They can't figure us out. We look at each other and we see mystery. But you know, that's kind of what keeps us interested, right? It's the mystery of them. It's what keeps things exciting, knowing that they're free, unpredictable, minds of their own. They're alive. Makes us feel alive, doesn't it? Mind you, I'll stick with celibacy myself, thank you very much. But this goes for anything that's alive. It's random, it's uncontrollable. Just when we think we've figured it out, it surprises us. Like my dog, Nemo, which someday you'll get the chance to meet, I hope. He's a cute little guy, little wiener dog, 10 pounds, long hair, cutest dog in the world. But not a very good dog sometimes. Some mornings I actually get the chance to sleep in, and if Nemo were a good dog, he would want to sleep in too. But no, he wants to go for his morning walk, so he starts barking to wake me up. Ruff! I say, "Nemo, be quiet!" So he tries to muffle it. "Nemo!" I say to him. And then I discover how perfectly his cold, wet nose fits directly into my belly button. Perfectly! And I go, "Ah!" And he goes, "Roo!" And off for our walk we go, little wiener dog. He's alive. He's got a mind of his own. We can even say this about plants, which don't have brains, but they're alive. They're kind of creepy, as a matter of fact. I mean, look at this plant here. Looks like an inanimate object, doesn't it? But it's not. If you leave it long enough, it will move. It gets bigger. Eventually, it will take over your house if you leave it long enough. Although it won't at my house, because they usually die within about 3 days. But any other house, they're alive. They're unpredictable. And the most alive, most free, most difficult to understand creatures of them all are human beings, particularly the human beings of the opposite sex. Of course, I don't have a wife myself. Instead, I have a congregation. As a matter of fact, technically, I'm sort of married to all of you. Surprise! Honey. I told that to a class of high school kids once, that I was married to all of them. The kid at the back of the class shouted, "I want a divorce!" But it's true, there's a dynamic, unpredictable relationship between us. Sometimes you laugh right when I want you to. Sometimes I want you to laugh and you don't. Sometimes I don't want you to laugh and you do. I don't like that very much, but that's the way it works. Same thing the other way. Sometimes I might say things that make you shift in your pews, like show of hands or that kind of thing, you know, ask you questions. Unpredictable, alive. Has our own freedom, minds of our own, can never be completely controlled. And personally, I don't think you even have to be biologically alive to be alive. Art can be alive. We have our painter painting her masterpiece in the kindergarten class, taking such pride in her work, pouring herself completely into it, so proud of it too. And then I go visit her school, and she gives it to me, right? She says, "Here you go." So cute too, right? And I want to show her how cool it is. I say, "Wow, what an amazing cow you've drawn here." She says, "That's not a cow, that's you, Father Mike." Now, if she had kept her art to herself, she wouldn't have risked my misinterpretation of her masterpiece. But the minute she shares it, it takes on a life of its own. The same thing could be said of music, really anything that we create and then share with someone else. As soon as we share it, we've given up control. Even the homilies that I give seem to take a life of their own. I've found in the last few weeks that parishioners are calling each other legs like a chicken and face like a mule. I've had little girls kissing Kermit the Frog puppets to try to turn them into Brad Pitt. I've got people trying to make rubber chickens fly through the air. I will spend hours a week on these homilies, making sure they say exactly what I want them to say, and then give them to you on Sunday, and then the parishioner comes up to me and says, "Oh, Father, I loved your homily today. I really liked when you said that we should be thankful for the small things." And I'm thinking, "I never said that." And then she says, "I liked it when you said God wants us to slow down in life and be patient, even when we're driving." And I know I didn't say that. And finally she says, "And it's so nice the way you say God is a dove." I'm like, "What? God is a dove? When did I say that?" "Oh, you know, you say it every homily. God is a dove. God is love, love, God is love," is what I say. But she heard something else. Sometimes people hear what they need to hear. As soon as I give the homily, as soon as I say it, the Spirit, you know, the dove, he takes it from there, and he uses it to plant a seed inside of you. The homily comes to life. So if it's alive, that's a great thing, it's a wonderful thing, but like anything that is alive, it cannot be controlled. Going back to the topic of romance, I'll tell you about my first love. She was beautiful. Brown hair, brown eyes, Italian girl from New York, funny, sincere, good Catholic girl, kind of rough around the edges, but I kind of like that, you know? She'd tell it to you straight, full of life. She was drop-dead gorgeous. When I first saw her at the age of 13, it was love at first sight, at least for me. It wasn't love at first sight for her because she's never seen me. But I saw her every Tuesday nights, 8 o'clock, 7 Central and Mountain on ABC. It was Alyssa Milano. Some of you know who I'm talking about? She's beautiful. She was on that TV show, Who's the Boss?, about some Italian guy from Brooklyn who becomes a housekeeper for a rich, uptight lady. I don't know what the show was about. I wasn't watching it for the plot. I was watching it for Alyssa Milano. If she had been calling the numbers on the bingo channel, I would have been watching for Alyssa Milano. So beautiful. I didn't care. She was my age. She was real short, so about my height, which I liked. She was athletic, so she could beat me up, which I also liked. And I knew that that's the girl that I'm going to marry right after I've won my Nobel Prize in Physics, walked on Mars, and bought a small island for the two of us. I used to tell my buddy Greg walking home from school how I wanted us to be together and what my plans were. He thought I was absolutely nuts. He said, right, I'll get you matching unicorns for your island, Michael. I even wrote her a letter once. It said something like, dear Alyssa, I think you are swell. You are a great actress. I think our children will be good actors and actresses as well. So now you know your beloved father, Mike, was a stalker. But one day, something terrible happened. Alyssa, my Alyssa, did the unthinkable. She dyed her hair. I thought, what? How could she do this? How could she change? My heart was broken in two. This was not the Alyssa that I had fallen madly in love with. I was in the depths of despair for about 30 minutes until I flipped the channel and fell in love again. This time with a tall, slender, beautiful glass of Pepsi. Anyway, my point is, I wasn't really in love with Alyssa Milano, was I? I was in love with my version of Alyssa Milano, with who I thought she was, my mental picture of her. The real Alyssa Milano, I have no idea what she's like. Might be the same, might be different. Who knows? The person I fell in love with doesn't really exist. The real Alyssa is alive. This is usually what happens when we get a crush on someone. We idolize them. We put them on a pedestal. We give all of our love and our attention and our devotion, not to the person themselves, but to who we think they are. And when they decide to do something else, well, then we have a problem. I can't tell you how many times I've had people come complaining to me, he changed on me. That's not the man I married. Or, I don't know them like I once did. Some parents find that their kids have minds of their own. How many of you parents there have kids with minds of your own? Hands up. Yeah, that's kind of what I thought. Yeah, isn't that wonderful that they do? Yeah, absolutely. And sometimes they come to me and they say, you know, I don't know who my son is anymore. I usually say, well, that's okay. They probably don't know who they are anymore either. I'm just trying to figure that out right now. And some people get really angry when our idols, the people we idolize, make mistakes. Remember what happened to Britney Spears a few years ago? She became the easy target for Jay Leno and David Letterman and all those comedians to make fun of her, as though she doesn't have feelings. And so off the pedestals they fall, all the people we idolize, and make us so mad and hurt when they do too, as did my Alyssa Milano. So I fell out of love with her, and into the seminary I went. The thing is, we have no right to do that. That's an injury to them when we decide who they are. Take away their freedom. The minute we decide that we have someone all figured out, pin them down, put them in a little box, label them, make up our minds about them, judge them, we take away that freedom. We don't want them to decide for themselves who they are. We take away part of their life. This is where statements like, the bishop is always right about everything, come from. You know what? That's not fair to the bishop to say that. That's putting too much on him, more than he can handle. And other statements like, all Americans are arrogant. All Muslims are evil. If you're suffering in life, it's because you're being punished. Only Catholics go to heaven. That person is going to burn in hell. Every priest under 40 with a ponytail is a lousy driver. What are you laughing at? These are very dangerous things to say, mainly because they're all wrong. Except maybe the last one. And I could prove it to you too, but you know what? I don't have to prove it. These people will prove it themselves because they're alive. We can even say this about God. Try to put God in a box, put labels on him, think we have him all figured out into our system, our way of thinking. God is male. God is female. God is white. God only loves people who obey him. God never changes. God rewards people who pray the rosary 5 times a day with 5 years without a head cold. Or God can't break the laws of nature. God can't forgive that guy. God is fighting on our side of this war. Some people can think they have God all figured out. Like the Sadducees. Those are those guys we heard about in our gospel today. Those are the guys who are the experts on the law, the Torah. For them, the Torah is the first 5 books of the Bible. It's about that much of the Bible. Just a small section. Books Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. That's it. For them, that was the inspired, divinely given word of God through the prophet Moses. Everything else that we have in our Bible is negotiable. But those 5 books, that is the word of God directly written for us. And one of the things it says in the Torah is this little thing about the guy whose wife dies, or no, who dies and his wife marries his brother and then his next brother and next brother and so on and so forth. They don't really care whose wife she is in the next life. What they're trying to do is prove to Jesus that it is illogical for there to be life after death. The Sadducees did not believe in heaven. Do you know why? Because heaven is not mentioned in the Torah, in Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, or Deuteronomy. It's not in there. So they're trying to logically prove to Jesus that because the law says such and such about brothers marrying this one woman, because if there was a heaven, she'd have to be married to all of them, well then there can't be a heaven. Period. It's logically impossible. God is prevented by the Bible from raising us from the dead. You know what Jesus' answer to that is? He says, give me a break, guys. God is God. God can do whatever he wants. And if he wants to raise us from the dead, he will. Period. You bunch of boneheads. That's what he says to the Sadducees. God isn't going to confine himself to one interpretation of the Bible, one person's opinion, one definition, one system, not even, believe it or not, one religion. At least that's what the documents of Vatican II tell us. They say there's truth about God in every one of the world's major religions. My experience is that every time I think I have God all figured out, he does something completely different. Every time. Never fails. Drives me crazy too. Why can't God just do what I want him to sometime? Do you know what I mean? When I was 18 years old, I looked up at God and I said, God, please show me what you want me to do with my life. And God answered. After 12 years of post-secondary education, 5 different majors, 3 degrees, 2 apartments, 4 car accidents, $11,000 in student loans, and 3 years out chasing after the woman I thought was the girl of my dreams, God answered. And here I am, your husband. Boy, is that ever frustrating, too. That God doesn't just work with my plans. Give me a straight answer. You know? It's scary having to wait for him, leaving it up to him to answer my prayers the way he chooses. Can't control him. That's scary. Someone who was scary about 20, 30 years ago was an archbishop in El Salvador. Just a humble, timid little bookworm guy. Military dictators decided to make him the archbishop in their country because they figured he was easy to control, right? That was until he learned about how badly the poor were being treated, about the corruption in his country, about the death squads stealing people out of their homes in the middle of the night and disappearing them. When he discovered that, he was furious. He was enraged. So, he did the unpredictable thing. He put on a little radio show on Sunday morning. And boy, did he ever make trouble for the government with that radio show. Of course, You should know what his name was, hopefully. His name was Archbishop Oscar Romero. He sure surprised them. Instead of controlling him, he scared the heck out of them. In fact, they were so scared. Do you know what they did? The only way that they could control him, they figured, was to destroy him. And that's why they assassinated him right in the middle of celebrating Mass. Right as he was elevating the cup, they shot him. We'll be naming him a saint one of these days. The Sadducees, they were scared of Jesus too. That's why they destroyed him. They figured the only way we can control him for sure is to get rid of him. They'd pin him down to a cross. They'd put him in a box, a tomb. When all else fails, the surest way to control someone that won't be controlled is to kill them. If his being alive is going to be a problem, then we'll just have to take away that life. So they did. But, once again, God, who is God, surprised them, amazed them. And that's the great thing about God. It's the great thing about anything that's alive, whether they be women or men, parents or kids, new dog or painting or homily or Alyssa Milano. If we can't control them, if they can startle us and scare us, then they can also amaze us. We can be astounded by that beautiful sunset that we can never reproduce. Exhilarated by that piece of music or masterpiece or picture by that six-year-old that she drew in kindergarten. We can be baffled by the newborn baby in our arms who's never going to do what we want them to. Only someone who's alive, who's free, who can't be fit into a box, can't be controlled, and can surprise us. Only they can make us laugh or cry or angry or peaceful, or only they can teach us. And that means that we are not alone. And if God keeps being so uncontrollable in our lives, ruining our plans, outsmarting us, challenging us, surprising us, well, that means that God is alive. It means we'll never be alone. It means He loves us. Means that God is love. Amen.